Well, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back to our Clinical Conversations program. And if this is your first time, welcome. So I'm Barry Servette. I'm the statewide medical director for MCPAP. It's really an honor to be able to tell you about our speaker for today. And so we'll get started with that in a moment. But before we do, I wanted to just give you some housekeeping things. We're still really excited about the fact that we now have CMEs for you. And so as you can see on the screen, you can use your phones to text the CME administrator to get your credit. And there's a code in there, J-E-Y-D-O-N, that you can use. And if it's the first time you're using it, you might have to fill out some registration information. At the end of the session, you are invited, and we're really hoping that you'll complete your evaluation and also give us feedback just about topics that you're interested in learning about in future sessions. The session will, as always, be recorded, and it's going to be available on the MCPAP website for people to stream if they weren't able to come to the live one. So please tell your friends and colleagues about it, and encourage them, especially if you enjoy the presentation. I'm very confident that you will. The PowerPoint slides will be available on the MCPAP website under the Tools and Resources page. Our presenter, Dr. Sperling, will stop for questions as needed. I'm going to moderate the questions, so just enter them into the question function on the Zoom, and I will read your question for the most part. If it's truly complicated, I might ask you to ask yourself. Depending upon the nature of the question, if it's relevant to what we're talking about at the time, I'll politely interrupt Dr. Sperling, if that's okay with her, to kind of ask the question. Otherwise, we'll save it towards the end. Let's get started. So our speaker today is Dr. Jacqueline Sperling. Dr. Sperling is a clinical psychologist. She is a member of the faculty at Harvard Medical School, and she is the co-founder and the co-director of the McLean Anxiety Mastery Program at McLean Hospital. She's also an author of a book with a wonderful title called Find Your Fierce, How to Put Social Anxiety in Its Place, and a contributor for Harvard Health Publishing. She specializes in evidence-based psychotherapy practices and models, including cognitive behavioral therapy, working with youth who present with anxiety disorders clinically, including obsessive compulsive disorders. And she also focuses on providing help to parents, so-called parent guidance therapy, by using structured models of treatment. She does behavioral parent training, and she helps families to address children's internalizing and externalizing behaviors. And so it's really a pleasure. We're excited to hear Dr. Sperling's presentation, and I will hand it straight to you, Jackie. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much for the very kind introduction and for having me here. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you. And I'm just going to share my screen. Okay, please let me know if you cannot see it. There we go. Okay, so before we get started, during the very kind introduction, you heard about a book I recently published with the American Psychological Association, Imagination Press, Find Your Fierce, How to Put Social Anxiety in Its Place for Young Adults. Although that is the target audience, really can apply for all ages. And so what are we going to cover today? So I appreciate that they're familiar with social anxiety, so I'll just do a brief overview and talk about some predisposing factors for social anxiety, because I really want to make a point that we don't want to wait until it crosses the threshold into social anxiety disorder. And so what are some things that you can do when you see families showing signs, or the children and their families showing signs along the way, and how it might show up in your office or outside of the office, and what treatment options are available, and the role of parents, and time for questions and discussion. And I'm also making note of, when I talk about the treatment, not just telling you what treatment is available, but I also talk about some ideas for how to present it to families so that they can understand what to expect, and also so you can know, sort of like as a checkpoint or as a reference when they come back in, to see, are they getting the care that they really need? Okay, so what is social anxiety disorder? A fear of being judged or embarrassed. It has to at least be with peers. So, you know, some children are shy around adults, so this has to be at least people around their age. And it has to interfere with their daily functioning, whether it's in school, social interactions, family gatherings. It often can be misdiagnosed as oppositional defiant disorder. You may hear families like, my child's really, you know, oppositional. And what that looks like is that when the child is faced with a really stressful social situation, they may do everything and anything it takes to avoid it. It's not necessarily that they actually have oppositional defiant disorder. It's that when there is this perceived need, that you're going to do whatever it takes to get it met, sometimes not in the most helpful ways, but particularly when you're in distress, you may go to great lengths to avoid. And it has to persist for at least 6 months. Truth be told, families with whom I work, this doesn't just show up out of the blue. It starts, you know, brewing over time, and then it may reach ahead at a certain point. And there also is a performance subtype. So there are some people where the symptoms really focus in, like when they're giving speeches or if they're performing extracurricular activities on stage. Although for some people on the flip side, some people are often surprised, you know, when they work with people with social anxiety disorder, that they actually are in theater and they perform on stage regularly. And when you talk to them, they often will say, well, I'm playing a character. So if someone judges in the performance, they're judging my character, not me. And it also is a time for them to feel like they're being someone else, is often what I hear. So just because someone performing on stage, I wouldn't rule out that they, you know, oh, they don't have social anxiety disorder. They very well may have it. And I appreciate in a previous presentation that you attended that there was a discussion of measures that you can use. You can use the SCARED measure that has questions on different anxiety disorders, and some of them are focused just on social anxiety disorder. I have the link here just so you can access it all in one place with this information for social anxiety disorder. So there are several questions, as I said, that focus on social anxiety disorder. It's a very good screener tool. And at the same time, I am going to talk about some additional ways where social anxiety can show up that may not necessarily be captured on that tool, so that you can keep an eye out for those examples. Okay, so it's the second most common anxiety disorder next to specific phobias. And average age of onset is 13, and that's because also, I mean, for a variety of reasons, but you can think also because peers become much more important to adolescents at that time. And as I said, I usually, you know, it starts brewing earlier, and I've worked with many children under the age of 13 who have social anxiety disorders. So it doesn't just have to show up in adolescence. It's quite prevalent, and it's really important that we do catch symptoms of social anxiety disorder, because it often can have a chronic unremitting course if we don't treat it. About 5% of those who experience social anxiety seek treatment within the first year, and what's more than a third wait 10 years or more to get help. So it's really key that we get help, and it makes sense that there are also delays. First of all, access is really tough. I don't have to tell all of you. We're probably looking at the challenges and trying to make referrals here, but also because if you have social anxiety disorder, it's hard to talk about your feelings with other people. So there may be that reticence there. So trying to help encourage them to get the support available. Okay, so let's talk about some predisposing factors, because as I said, I want to talk about what are some things you can look out for from, you see them from the very beginning. So what can you look out for along the way here? And the apple doesn't fall very far from the tree. You're 3 times more likely to develop social anxiety disorder if you have a parent who has it as well. There's also a type of temperament that's associated with social anxiety disorder, behavioral inhibition. This is a reticence to all sorts of new experiences, not just social ones. So they're just to see the child clinging behind the parent's leg. And if you start seeing this in the office or hearing that they're, you know, anytime they go to a new event or meet someone new, that my child's always, you know, hiding behind me, that's sort of like, have your antenna up that maybe a child has a, you know, behaviorally inhibited temperament. And research followed children for 5 years, 6 years of age, and they did find that a behaviorally inhibited temperament was associated with lifetime anxiety disorder and also a new onset. It didn't predict other anxiety disorders though, so it really has a specific link to social anxiety. Okay. So in addition to temperament, also, you know, keeping an eye out for what's the relationship like this child has caregivers in the home, or even outside of the home, that if there are caregivers that are unpredictable, unreliable, don't communicate effectively, that can also set children up to feel like the relationships in their lives are not going to be reliable or predictable. And so they can go in kind of two different extremes. They might try to reject people before they get rejected themselves, or they might only try to seek reassurance to make sure that people don't leave them, that might be a self-fulfilling prophecy because that often can push people away. So based on some of their early experiences and attachment with their caregivers, that also can inform how they interact with others on the road. There also are interactions with temperament and also parenting styles. So using Baum-Ryan's parenting styles, using the dimensions of warm and accepting and versus cold and accepting, and also how demanding one is. I'm also sorry, I hope you can add here, some decided to do some construction outside the building. Okay, so there's authoritative, where you're high on warm and accepting and also demanding. And also there's authoritarian, this is more demanding, and it's sort of like there's no warmth, like you may toe the line, but there's no warmth involved. Neglectful, you know, there's no warmth, but they're also no rules, no towing the line or anything. You're just not involved. And there's also, you're really warm and accepting, but there are no rules there. And really just sort of like children often kind of rule the roost there. And what we find is that permissive, so like although there's warm and acceptance, not having boundaries or any predictability or knowing sort of like where this containment is actually can increase internalizing symptoms or distress. And that, by the way, please let me know if that sound is distracting for all of you. But authoritative on the flip side, so they're still warm and accepting, but with this behavioral inhibition, but they toe the line, that actually can decrease internalizing symptoms. So this will talk about some parenting techniques where you can help parents like still be warm and accepting, but also encourage them to help them also set limits so that their children have boundaries and then help contain their internalizing symptoms. And those parents who can be over-controlling or critical and also just really trying to shield their children from any challenging experience, and the child has a behaviorally inhibited temperament, that can actually perpetuate the behavioral inhibition and also some emergence of social anxiety symptoms. So just different type of parenting styles to look out for, right? So if someone's warm but also towing the line, I think that also contains some of the distress. If they're not towing the line, that can be also a red flag. Then they're also like really trying to hover over them and not let them experience the world. That also can be a red flag there. Okay. And so there are more interactions here. So how parents perceive the world and what they model and the interaction there can also impact children's anxiety and their behavior. So parents with anxiety, they tend to perceive ambiguous situations as more threatening. So if you think of, for example, like someone who's standing outside a store looking down at their phone and a parent's with their child and they need to ask directions somewhere, they might think, oh, you know what? I'm not going to ask that person because they'll get mad at me for interrupting them while they're on their phone. Versus, you know, how do you know that? It's an ambiguous situation. They may not get mad at you. They may offer you directions, but maybe perhaps that parent will decide to avoid asking for directions. So that example is what's modeled for the child. And they think, oh, I should not ask a stranger for directions because they might get mad at me. So I should avoid that. So keeping in mind that it's not just what the child is doing, it's like, what are they seeing in their environment that may also be informing their decisions? Okay. So how does it show up? You know, a lot of people think it's just by raising, you know, a hand in class or maybe giving a speech, but there's so many other ways where it can show up. So eating in front of others, I would say lunch is a really big one for the kids with whom I work. And it's for a variety of different reasons. Some people are worried about calling attention to themselves, like if they eat crunchy foods. Some kids are worried about having food stuck in their teeth. Some kids are worried about being judged for the different kinds of foods that they eat. There's a whole range of things that could be challenging for them. And using public restrooms as well. And so oftentimes these kids, like you may want to even ask like whether or not they're eating at school, but also are they drinking water? So a lot of kids will restrict, not because they're trying to change how their body looks, but because they're terrified of using the restroom at school. And then they'll come home and be starving and ravenous, and then they'll eat a lot when they come home. So finding out, are they eating in school? Are they drinking at school? Are they using public restrooms? Can they order in restaurants? And some people would just say like, oh, sure, I order from this fast food restaurant all the time. And then I would clarify, like, how are you ordering? Because I often will find out they're using an app on a phone and then just picking it up, another form of avoidance. So find out actually, how are they ordering? Participating in class, like I said, and then not just participating in class, I would find out like, are they participating in class when they're not totally sure of the answer? Because some people will only do it if they know the answer, because they would never want to be caught with uncertainty or maybe getting the answer wrong. Participate in extracurricular activities, often particularly the ones that are performance-based, speaking in front of groups, attending large gatherings, birthday parties, a big one, exercising in front of others. If at lunch is a big one, PE is a huge one. And that can be for a variety of different reasons with performance, but also a lot of these kids do not want to show themselves blushing or sweating. They find that very embarrassing. So keep in mind, there's a whole wide range of ways that these are just some examples too. So with all these, you know, predisposing factors and how it might show up, there's also hope because there's treatment that can help. And so now we're going to transition into how you might present some of these support options to families should they choose to seek them in a way that's sort of like family oriented so that they know what to expect, and also then again so that you can use it as a check. Okay. So cognitive behavioral therapy, or CBT, with exposure and response prevention, ERP, is well established. This is not who I presented to families, but I'll get to that in a second. And so this is the gold standard of treatment, and involving parents in treatment can reduce behavioral inhibition. So I'm all about involving parents, particularly when you go over the treatment models so that they know what to expect and also so that they can help support the treatment. And then we'll also talk about some techniques that are specific for parents and how they might be involved in therapy, or at least in adjunctive therapy as well. So when I'm meeting with kids and I'll say, have you ever heard of cognitive behavioral therapy before, CBT? Sometimes yes, sometimes no, usually no. And I was like, that's a type of therapy that teaches you the connection between your thoughts, feelings, and behaviors, and teaches you tools how to manage all of them. There's also a special type of CBT. It's called exposure and response prevention. Have you ever heard of that before? Usually no. And that's teaching you how to gradually face the fears that are challenging for you without doing things that might keep the anxiety growing, keep those worries growing, like avoid things or use safety behaviors that may like distract us and make realize that we do not allow us to learn that we can do it. And then you might see some wide eyes, like, hear me out. We'll talk about what it looks like. And I'll say, think about a swimming pool, not on a really hot day, but more on like a chilly day, like in the 60s. And if I were to say, hey, why don't you go jump in the deep end? What would you say? Usually I would say, no. And I'm like, all right, all right, all right. How about if you dip your big toe in the shallow end? All right, fine. How might it feel at first? A little cold? Right. After 15 minutes, what might happen? Get kind of used to it. Yeah, so what might happen if I then ask you to dip your next toe in? Sure, okay. Why? Well, because I got used to it with the other toe. Oh, and then you could do it. So then same thing going up to your ankles, asking them up to their knees, up to their waist, up to their neck. And I'll say, hey, what about dunking your head? What might you say? Okay, why? Well, I got kind of used to the water. Sure, so you got your whole body wet that way. You could have gotten your whole body wet by jumping in the deep end. That would have been a shock to your system though. So this treatment, ERP, starts with your big toe, goes at your pace, no one forces you to do anything. You're the expert on what's your big toe, and you ease your way in. teaching your body that you can do it. And we're going to teach you about how this treatment actually works. And before we get started with that, I'm just going to give you sort of a tool that we use in this treatment, and it's a feelings thermometer. And I'll say, have you heard suds before? Not the soap suds, usually a resounding no. And so I'll edit out and say it's subjective because it's how you feel. Units, we're measuring it, of distress, your worries. On a scale of 0 to 10, 10 being the most distressed or worried you could be, 0 not at all. And I'll say, what would your, you know, suds be, for example, if you're sitting in your cozy pants on the couch, eating your favorite snack, watching your favorite show, usually around a 0 for kids. And then I'll say, oh, okay, well, what would your suds be if you had to sing the national anthem in front of a packed Fenway? Usually wide eyes. Is there something above a 10? Oh, so you can see there's a range, right? Between the hyperboles that they can see, playful about it. So we use these feeling thermometers to see where things might be at for you, different your suds levels, different situations. Okay, and then we'll talk about how we use that feelings thermometer and the different models to show how exposure response prevention works. So, two different models, one we used to use, one we now use, and I'll tell you why we use them both, because one informs the other. So, I'll just say, have you ever heard about the habituation model? No. This is where I'll put suds on the y-axis and time on the x-axis, and I'll say, okay, say for example, someone's worried about going to school. When they get to the door, their suds are a 6. What do they have the urge to do? Go home. Yes, get out of there. And what happens to their suds when they go home? They go down. Thank goodness I did not go there. All right. What happens the next day when they go to the school? Higher, lower, or the same? You can think higher. Why? Because they didn't go in, so now it feels really scary. Yeah, it feels extra scary. So what do they have the urge to do? Go home. Right. And then you go home, and then what happens the next day? Suds are higher. Yes. Ah, there's like this vicious cycle, and it keeps getting worse and worse. You know what? And then school does become a scary place behind at work. Kids are asking where you've been. Ah, what? So let's think about, let's try another approach. What do you think might happen when you get to the school door and suds are 6 if someone stays? Well, it might be a bumpy road, but eventually it might go down. Yeah. Why? In fact, you can't actually be anxious ever. It's physically impossible. Some thoughts and feelings can make it go on for some time, but you can't be anxious forever. And also, you learn you can do it. And so the next time, what do you think happens when you get to the school door? Higher, lower, the same? Maybe lower. Oh, why? Well, I learned I could do it last time. You're right. And it might take a little less time to come down, a little less time to come down. We don't want to get rid of anxiety forever. And you may be thinking, why not? And that's because we need some of it to help us prepare for things. Before you cross the street, what do? Look both ways. Not a good idea to do anything else. And so if you have a test the next day, what do? Study. You wouldn't do so well in school if you didn't do that. So we need some anxiety. We just not have it be in charge of us. Now, past research, you should think this is how exposures work. The more you do them, the more your suds come down. But that doesn't actually have to happen in order for them to be successful. And I'm going to tell you why. Have you heard of the inhibitory learning model? Yeah, no. Well, there are two possible outcomes with exposures in this model that we now use for research. And let's say it's either not as bad as you expect it to be, and or maybe it was, and you learn that you can handle it. And I'm going to step to the side. The reason why I teach them both, by the way, is also one kind of helps set the stage for the other to show it works and so that they can see if their provider is actually using the current model, and for you too. Okay, so the inhibitory learning model is like, think of neurons, which are the cells in your brain that talk to each other, as like cars. And anytime your brain does a behavior or learns how to do something, it paves cement to make a highway. So you get to that school and you're like, get me out of here. As the neurons of those cars start driving on cement paving and avoid highway. Do not go to school. That place is danger, 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 dangerous. And so the more you do it, the more cement you pave in that highway. But with exposure and response prevention, you make a construction zone. You put up a do not enter sign and you're like, oh, wait, it's not as bad as I expected it to be. Like, oh, maybe it was. You know what? I learned that I can handle it. And you start paving cement on the approach highway. And the more that you go and learn that you can do it, the more cement you pave in that highway and the more likely those cars are going to drive on that highway. Now, the thing is, you can't erase highways in the brain. Sometimes on stressful or windy days, that do not enter sign gets knocked down. And those cars are like, what's over here? Don't go to school. The thing is, all is not lost. with some extra skill practice, you can put that sign back up and remind those cars, all right, it's not as bad as I expected it to be, or you know what it was, and I learned that I can do it. And I tell you these things that A, your suds don't need to come down in order for an exposure to be a success. If you did the exposure, it's a success. And two, also to keep in mind that there may be some times when we're more stressed out where anxiety is like, ooh, lunch, and tries to take charge, we can still boss it back. And so stepping aside again now, talking to all of you, this is really key for those who struggle with perfectionism, because oftentimes they think, oh, my suds ended up being higher than what I thought it was. I failed. And for them really to us, you did the exposure. That was a success. So having them keep that in mind, and also to prepare for the future that it's not this linear line of improvement. Okay. There are different types of exposures. In vivo are the ones that we do live, like ordering in restaurants, raising your hand in class. Really, those are super powerful. It's the most effective. Interoceptive as well. These are the exposures that expose you to physiological symptoms that may be as a result of anxiety. And so for people also who fear blushing or sweating, we might have them practice doing jumping jacks or running in place and getting really hot and having their cheeks blush before they do an exposure and talk to someone. Okay. Imaginal exposure, this is when you don't have access to certain stimuli. So like, for example, someone's, if you're being on a plane, you can't just hop on a plane all the time. So this is when they were used to really help them like close their eyes and walk them through every single step of the process to expose them to that feared situation. Really though, I mean, now we have access to virtual reality, even with like cheap Google Cardboard glasses that you can use. So really often find that these are used the least often. And so if there's anything that you can do in person or interoceptive exposures, even virtual reality, I would say those tend to be the biggest bang for your buck there. Okay. So I often will use, I'm all about analogies, as you may have seen with the swimming pool, a ladder analogy. They'll make a fear and avoidance hierarchy or a bravery ladder for the younger kids, where each rung is a suds level of things they fear the most, not things they fear the least. And I'll often say, like, imagine that a ladder is leaning against my office door. What happens to the height of the ladder as you start knocking off the bottom rungs? Like, we'll get shorter, right? Right, so the top of the ladder no longer seems as far away or as hard to get to, or that deep end of the swimming pool is no longer as far away, right? So as you gradually start to approach your fears, the things that may seem really, really scary right now are going to feel not far out of reach, and that's how this treatment is going to work. So you collaborate, and they'll collaborate and create a bravery ladder, their provider, and rank their fears and least to most feared, and then they go at their own pace. This is also something I like to set the stage for expectations, and also just so you know, for what your patients might be experiencing. Overlearning. As humans, we drift. So it's really important that we don't just do everyday exposures. And often say, here's every day, here's where anxiety likes to pull us, and here's where exposure and response prevention is. And I'll often use the example of a New Year's resolution. Have you ever met someone who's made a New Year's resolution? Usually a yes. Have you ever met someone who's kept it 365 days a year? Usually a no. And that's because as humans, we drift. So say my New Year's resolution is, after work, I'm going to the gym, and January 1st, I am strong out the gates every day after work. And then the next week, I'm like, ugh, tired. I'll go tomorrow. And then it's 3 days a week, 2 days a week, 1 day a week. And then lo and behold, my workout routine is sitting on the couch, and I reach for the chip and I put it in my mouth and I reach for the chip. Can you imagine like the bicep curls, right? So as humans, we drift. So if we just did everyday exposures like raising your hand and you need the answer in class or ordering in restaurants regularly, that would give us room to come back where anxiety likes to pull us to avoid. So gradually, not right away, we work our way up to doing above and beyond everyday exposures to give you room to come back to the everyday. You may be wondering, what do those look like? Well, that might be going into a 24-hour pharmacy and asking them what time they close, or standing in front of a Starbucks and asking someone where the Starbucks is, raising your hand in class when you're giving a wrong answer, showing yourself, even though that's uncomfortable, you can do it. Now, that's not the everyday. You just want to teach your brain that you can do it. So it gives you room to come back to the everyday. I'm also going to show you a video that you can show I mean, I'm technically an adult. I still think it's a good video. Maybe some of the younger kids might find it more appealing. It's Sarah Bareilles' Brave video. I'm going to show you some example of also of overlearning for exposures for social anxiety. I'll show you a couple minutes of it, but if it piques your interest, feel free to see the whole thing. I just want to make sure we get through the rest of it. Okay, going to stop sharing my screen just for a second and then switch to video. That's my second. And hopefully you can see the Sarah Bareilles video. I just switched the tabs. I hope you can see it. And here we go. Second. I would love to play that whole video. If we have time, I can go back. I have a personal favorite for the dancer in the library. Okay, so let's go back to my slides here. And all right, so let's talk about, I was talking about all different ways to present the treatment to children. And yes, children are a core part of the treatment there, but anxiety takes over the whole family. And it's really important that we don't just help support the child, we help support caregivers. And really, if you do great work with a child and send them back into the same environment, they're likely not going to be able to sustain gain. So it's really important that we offer support for parents too. And so when you start to see these precursors for social anxiety, you do not have to wait until it crosses that threshold for social anxiety disorder. I am biased. I clearly have drunk the waters. I really am passionate about these treatments. I really think that if you have a child, behavioral parent training is really helpful. And this is based on the premise of really helping parents reallocate their attention to more helpful behaviors and gradually take it away to the less helpful ones. And I, probably not surprisingly, have an analogy for you to come for that one. And it's also, you might find with these parents, particularly the ones who may be demonstrating a permissive parenting strategy, that their children are in such distress, like, you know what, I'm just going to take everything off the table for them so they're no longer doing chores, they're no longer have any responsibilities, or parents don't feel like they can set any limits at home. You know, like, they're so stressed out, I don't want to add more to them. And then parents often feel helpless. They're like, I'm supposed to be a parent, but I don't really know what to do here if I can, because I don't want to make them feel worse. They're afraid to make their children feel worse. It's also another way to help these parents teach their children how to foster independence. I have a clip for that too. Other components like reducing accommodation so that they can experience mastery and independence. And we also talk about self-care. When I say we, I'm talking about the McLean Anxiety Mastery Program for these parents. Teach them all these tools to help their children and at the same time also help themselves. And often we use an analogy. So when you're on the airplane, right, the flight staff will tell parents to put the oxygen mask on themselves before they put it on their children. And it's for so many different reasons when we talk about this, just a few to mention that it's a way to model self-care for kids. It's also so that you have enough resources to care for your kids. And also, if you're taking care of yourself, you're not always there for your kids. And in a helpful way, you create opportunities for your children to practice mastery. And then also validation, teaching parents how to acknowledge feelings without dismissing them. People often find that feelings are really uncomfortable. So how can you actually acknowledge them as a way for emotion regulation tool? So these are a lot of the different treatment components that we have in our program, and you can refer parents. You know, there are some providers who do strictly behavioral parent training. You might want to see if they also fold in opportunities to reduce accommodation and fostering independence, for example, for the kids who present with internalizing symptoms. You may have heard of the SPACE protocol that was developed at Yale, and that is really just a treatment just for parents who have children who present with anxiety disorders, and that helps parents reduce accommodation. It's really great in that respect. I also am a strong believer that some of these additional components can be really helpful. So that can be a good starting place. But also just thinking about, are they getting these additional components? Okay. So I mentioned an analogy. Here we are. So I like to use a garden analogy as the foundation for the parenting techniques that I discuss with parents. And it's based on the attention principle that I like to repeat because I think it's pretty powerful. It's based on the attention principle that any behavior that gets attention is likely to continue. And I'll say it again. Any behavior that gets attention is likely to continue. I'll say to parents, even if you yell at it, snarl at it, give it a disgusted sigh, if you touch it, grab by the shirt, that is really strengthening that behavior. And it seems so backwards. Why if I yelled it? Why would it keep happening? And that's because parents' attention, it's like gold for kids. And so we really want to have parents shift to think, okay, wait a second. Yes, a squeaky wheel understandably gets the grease, but can we help them reallocate their attention to more helpful behaviors, given how powerful their attention is? So I'll say, take a rose. It takes just the right amount of sunlight, water, and nutrients to thrive. A dandelion, you so much as blink in a dandelion's direction and they're everywhere. Like, I just picked you, what happened? Those are the unhelpful behaviors. The rose, more helpful behavior. It takes a lot more nurturing to get those to thrive. So for parents to keep that in mind, that this is hard work. So particularly for behavioral parent training, we start focusing on watering that rose, because if you just start taking attention away from the dandelions, you're going to see an extinction burst. These dandelions are like bullies. They're used to being in charge. If a bully gets lunch money every day and all of a sudden you're like, not today, is it going to say, all right, see you later? No, it's going to put up a fight or up the ante. So we really want to have a solid foundation of skills and not build a house of cards. Often parents understandably are eager, like, help me with the dandelions. Like, we want to definitely get there. And we really need to have the solid foundation of watering the rose first so that there's motivation for these children to have the attention pulled away from the dandelions. And this also pairs well with exposure and response prevention, because we often are helping parents pull attention away from reassurance seeking that the anxiety often does, and that reinforces the anxiety. So if you're pulling all that attention away, we really need to have parents reallocate it. And this might look like child-directed interaction, a tangible reward system, labeled praise. There are ways to make that developmentally appropriate, even for teens. So this is the analogy for a foundation, just something to keep in mind if you're like, if you're making a recommendation for treatment or support options for parents, help for what they might look. And I have another clip, not a surprise. So before I go on to this next technique and to talk about ways of fostering independence, I'm going to show you another clip. And I have this idea from my colleagues, always like to give credit where credit is due. And I will show this clip before I mention the skill to parents, because I feel like it says a lot. So for anyone who has not seen the movie Ray Charles or the story of Ray Charles was not born blind. Ray Charles had an accident and a young child that allows him to lose his sight. And so this is from that movie where he's having a memory shortly thereafter he lost his sight. And just a warning, this clip tugs at the heartstrings. Need to make this small. We don't want Brave again, sorry. I think we want Brave again. We don't want Brave again. All right. Here we go.
Help! Mama! Mama, help! Mama, help! Mama, help, please! I need you! Mama!
Thank you.
there.
Yes, I am.
Why are you crying, Mama?
'Cause I'm happy.
Take a moment, so I can appreciate that can evoke a lot of emotions there. It's a pretty powerful clip, and I get it, cinematography, and I will mention that to parents, and often ask them, like, what did you notice? And they often will reflect and show that, you know, that was been excruciating for her to resist, you know, helping him. And what ultimately happened was that he learned to fine-tune his other senses, because she gave him the space to do so. But if she swooped in, he would have been fully dependent on her for the foreseeable future. And often parents were reflecting, like, oh, you know, I see ways where I often step in, and I really validate their experience. Like, look, like, this goes against all of your parental instincts. You see your child in distress, your instincts tell you to go help them and make them feel better, right? And here's the thing, is that comes with such kind and good and supportive intentions. And it inadvertently teaches kids that they're helpless. They can't do it. And so it's really important that we create opportunities to help foster independence and facilitate this experience of mastery, even if it's uncomfortable. As painful as it is to see children in distress, remind yourself that emotions will not hurt them. They're really powerful communication tools and learning tools. And it creates opportunities for them to learn how to get back up. So all these different experiences where it might just be easier for you to go to the restaurant, telling the parent and put in the order, give your child an opportunity to order themselves. Make sure you're also modeling that too, and not just using an app all the time, you know, creating opportunities. Or you're at the grocery stores, they can pay at the, you know, the cash register. They want to know where the bathroom is, you're out in public, instead of just, oh, let's go, I think it's over there. Encourage them to go ask, you know, an employee there where the bathroom might be. So creating opportunities where they have to do things themselves, kids often will feel really good about themselves once they can do it. So encouraging parents, finding for them to create these opportunities, seeing what the kids can actually do on their own, what parents will let them do on their own, what parents are doing for them. You know, it can feel very good as a parent to feel needed. You only have that for so long. And at the same time, a parent's role is really to create an experience of obsolescence and be there for emotional support for a distance along the way. They really to create that opportunity for children to be able to do things on their own. So you may have parents coming in, asking you also, again, thinking about that premise where they might be feeling really their child's in distress and they want to remove that distress. And they might say, hey, doctor, can you please write a letter to excuse my child fill in the blank from an activity? And, you know, it might be from having to, you know, be called on in class or participate in gym class or have to go to this field trip, like thinking about what they might have to do. And then they're asking you to write a letter. And, you know, we really want to create opportunities to set these children up for success. And I appreciate being put on the spot and thinking, okay, what do I do here? And so it can be a great opportunity to show families it's not all or nothing. We don't want to dismiss a child's distress, let's say if it's participating in class. And we want to set the stage that, like, we believe you can do it, and let's find a way where there's a gradual approach. So if participating in class is really hard, but like when you're unsure of the answer, so cold calling is really hard, maybe we talk about the school as well. A child is just getting started with treatment, ultimately with the aim to help support them with class participation. So you're getting them on a path to do that. Maybe there's a time limited request for teachers not to cold call. So only call a child when the child has raised their hand for a specific period of time, and then we'll reevaluate. And then this way, as the child's working their way up to volunteer to raise their hand, they then can do so on their own volition, but know it's a safe place to practice, and that they're not going to be called on the spot. That might help with school attendance if that were an issue, if they're worried about being called on without raising their hand. And then hopefully that they're working toward that in treatment and getting support to do that. So it's not all or nothing, like, okay, we'll just take participation off the table. It's like, okay, we're going to support you in a time-limited way while you're also working on this to gradually approach the situation. There can be a lot of, you know, all or nothing thinking, and helping families see that there are ways to break down feared situations with the model of saying, we're going to help you get there. It's a gradual process, and we're not going to throw you into the deep end. Okay. There are phrases I will repeat with parents. This treatment is so tough. As I said, it goes against all their parental instincts. We're asking them to let their children experience distress and not swoop in. And that's why it's also really important to teach parents what exposure response prevention is all about. With their children, be doing things that create discomfort so that parents don't go in and stop them from feeling discomfort or try to curtail it. And that can be an exposure for parents. So helping prepare them. And just when they're feeling like being the worst parent, they feel like they're being the worst parent, they're likely being the best parent. And that's because they're not supporting the dandelions, they're supporting the rose. And to remind them that their child is not the dandelion, although it's so good at masking itself to look like the rose, that's not the child. And so you may feel like you're being the worst parent, you're likely being the best parent because this goes against all of your instincts. And I also mentioned that extinction burst, that when you start pulling attention away from the dandelions and the bullies that's used to getting attention, things will get worse before it gets better. So it's really important for parents to continue to toe the line, be consistent, and know that if they're consistent, things will get better. It's just really tough in the beginning. So that was a lot. And I'm going to transition to questions and also leave my contact information here, because please feel free to reach out anytime. Always happy to answer any questions. Always happy to collaborate in any which way, and always want to support the community. So appreciate all that you do. And so thank you.
All right. Well, it looks like we have one question from Leah Diskin. And the question is, do you have advice for working with families whose parents are not able to regulate themselves? For example, a parent with PTSD. Do you work with the parent and child separately? Do you ever recommend that parents seek treatment prior to working with their child? Great question.
That is a great question. You know, it depends right on that family there. It is very common if we find that a parent is experiencing significant distress, wanting to make sure that they have their own support as this treatment, you know, the anxiety takes over the whole family. And we want to make sure that their distress is being regulated so that they, and then in turn, can be there for their children. We, meaning at the McLean Anxiety Mastery Program, have found so we measure parental distress on a weekly basis, and we have found that parents giving them support in the treatment and involving them in treatment, actually, you know, their distress levels come down. It may also be that, like, you know, and their children's distress levels come down, and thinking about, you know, what predicted what. So actually, parents that had greater changes in and reductions in their distress, their children had greater reductions in their own distress. And so we decided also then to start monitoring the distress weekly instead of just at the beginning, at the end, to see, you know what, we should probably see if parents' distress levels are not going down, because if so, then we want to make sure that they're getting adequate support. And maybe that might make an additional individual therapy referral in addition to all the parent group or family meetings that we might have, or just some separate parent time within the family meeting, so that the child can continue to make gains.
Thank you. So Karen Shekowich, she's asking about a reading list for parents and for kids. Some families feel more comfortable starting the process by reading about it first. And I assume your book, Find Your Fierce, is definitely at the top of the list. Let's see what you think.
Yes, thank you. So that was written in mind, you know, to increase access, and it is written directly to the child. But again, you know, adults can read it too. So I think parents can also take skills, you know, learn them as well. Parents sometimes find that You and Your Anxious Child by Anne Marie Albano can be really helpful in terms of how to reduce accommodation as well. Helping Your Anxious Child by Repay, they're very similar in terms of just the Australian version for parenting. And I would say also Ellie Leibowitz has written a book, you know, about the SPACE protocol for parents, and that's about reducing accommodation as well. So I think there's some parenting books. I think the book for social anxiety, there are there's the Find Your Fierce as well, but it's
in the options. Okay, thank you. So Dr. Eric Ruby he said, good lecture. And he wonders about whether there are any one-page handouts that could be helpful for pediatricians to use. And he points out that actually, in his words, he says, unfortunately, Zoloft and Prozac are the fast answers in a 15-minute visit. And so I guess, you know, this, you know, question sort of corresponds to, you know, what, you know, how can pediatricians, you know, make best use of, you know, really limited time and be helpful, you know, to parents and especially when it comes to, you know, sort of behavioral recommendations and things like that.
You know, and I so appreciate, like I said, what do you do in 15 minutes? And probably social anxiety is not the only topic that you're covering there. And it might be that actually then you're referring them to some resources, right? You know, all the books I mentioned probably at libraries, so families wouldn't have to spend any money. ADAA, so the Anxiety and Depression Association of America, has a lot of great resources. And I know that in June it's not up yet, but I will be giving a webinar just also talking to youth about social anxiety and what treatments are helpful. And it's supposed to be like 15 minutes. So it's, you know, thinking about like they don't have to invest much time to watch it. So that could be referring to them to links. They have different like little like brief descriptions of different anxieties or the different treatments that are available. They have a list of providers who are trained in the treatment. So that can be something too, just kind of referring them to resources that they then can explore more. If you don't have the time in the session.
Great. And 15 minutes is kind of like sometimes even longer than pediatricians have with the face-to-face time. Obviously, if you have a crisis, you know, you're gonna spend more time, but social anxiety is such a bread and butter, you know, issue, I think, in primary care. So the time will definitely be limited. So one person on the call has just asked about whether you offer a remote treatment and whether it's covered by Mass Health. And so this might be a good sort of segue to telling us about your center and how people can refer patients. Sure. And the services they can.
Absolutely. So the McLean Anxiety Mastery Program is an intensive outpatient group-based program for children ages 6 to 19, although we have a separate child track, 6 to 13, and ages 14 to 19 for the adolescent track. It's group-based for children with anxiety disorders and or OCD. Right now we are fully virtual, although we are aiming to later on the year transition to a hybrid program where one day we would be in person. Well, obviously with COVID, things will depend on how the pandemic unfolds at that time. It is a hybrid also of insurance-based session and self-pay, but we do have a need-based scholarship program available. So you can apply it with it and just mention that might be something that might be helpful. And if you're interested or seems like it might be a fit or you know of some patients where it might be helpful for them, if you Google the McLean Anxiety Mastery Program, we have our website and then you scroll down and click the link to the application. Families can complete and submit that online, and then that will begin the phone screen process to see if it would be a fit to schedule an intake. Our program is, as I mentioned, it's 4 days a week for a minimum of 4 weeks. Many families do extend beyond that. It's in the afternoons. Roughly, I say 2 to 5 is because some days go to 2 to 4:30 and the family days go to 2 to 5. The kids are in a group 3 days a week where we often will go into like one-on-one or two-on-one for exposure and response prevention. It's very individualized. And then they come together for a group where they learn skills. And then we also, at the same time, the kids are learning skills, caregivers have their own support and skills group. And then we also have a family day where every family gets assigned a psychologist and a psychiatrist. They don't have to have medications. It's another opportunity for a consult. And we have family meetings. At the end of every group, there's also a checkout with parents to learn what exposures were done, what the plan is for that night to practice, and the rewards for the tangible reward system. So parents are very, very involved, and we communicate with schools and outpatient providers as well. It's not to say that's the only program available. I'm also happy to talk about other programs in the community as well. So I'm not trying to just for the McLean Anxiety Mastery Program if people on a different format. The last thing I will just say about our program for short, which is MAMP, McLean Anxiety Mastery Program, is that you don't have to be a certain cross a certain threshold of like an anxiety symptoms. We have people who've never had treatment before. They have some symptoms and they just would like to get some treatment momentum, and it's in the bud right now to get back on track, because 1 month of our program is about a year of outpatient treatment if you think about all the sessions that they get. But there's also weekly outpatient therapy. I believe Judge Baker Center for Effective Child Therapy accepts Blue Cross Blue Shield, but they also have a sliding fee scale. They have virtual and in-person, and it's weekly. They also offer behavioral parent training too. That's an option.
Great, thank you so much. The same person, Kathleen Herzaya, was interested in getting sort of a list of some of the resources that you mentioned, if they're not on the slides. So we can be in touch and we'll send that out to the group. Just in case other people are interested in them as well. I assume like the reading list and
happy to send everything. Mm-hmm.
Great, thanks so much. Okay, I'm sort of not seeing any more questions. So I think we will close, wait a minute, there might be more. Let me see. Oh, in the chat. No, those are all CME things. And Jonna, maybe Jonna, you can send out the code and the number so that people can kind of, you know, sort of get some help with that, because it looks like a number of people are having difficulty with the CME, you know, sort of function. So we'll do that. And Dr. Sperling, that was really wonderful and fascinating, actually, and I think really useful for people to know about. And so thank you so much again for joining us and for the really nice presentation.
Thank you so much for having me, for the kind of welcoming format. And also thank you to all that you do here, supporting all the children and families and community. I know I speak for all of us at MAMP. We're so grateful for all of you. And thank you to all those who coordinated this talk as well. And your great questions, thanks. Everyone.
And thanks everybody for your attendance in the audience. And we'll see you next month, actually. We have our last clinical conversations before the summer break next month. So thanks again, everybody.
I just sent in the chat that the attendance gets cut off by MGH at a certain time. So if you would like attendance and you weren't able to do the text, just send an email to mcpap@beaconhealthoptions.com letting me know that you would like to get credit for the CME, and I'll make sure that they understand that you were there.
Thank you, everybody.